And on today's video, we're going to carry on with our lesson, still on chapter 2. As I said, chapter 2 is the same as chapter 1, but the difference now is that now you are going to talk about the power factor correction. Okay? So let's first of all define what is our power factor correction, and then we can continue with our problem solving. Okay? So we all know that we have our triangle, our impedance triangle. So this is a pure resistor. It's always at the angle of zero. You have your inductance at 90 degrees, and then you have your impedance. Okay? And then here you have your power factor angle. Okay? So what's happened now is that with this resistor, you're gonna have a active power. With this inductance, you're gonna have a reactive power, and as well your complex power. So that's why it's always said that the impedance triangle and then your complex power triangle, they are the same, because this power factor angle is the same. Okay? And then we say that the power factor angle is the angle difference between the voltage and our current. Okay? So let's define it theoretically. You see, for instance, when you look at your motor is made of coil. Okay? So those big motors, for instance, if you start at the beginning, because that motor has a lot of coil, so it's a reactive component, it's a reactive element. So when you start that motor, you realize that that motor is going to require a lot of current at the beginning. So like for instance, when you go back in my country, because the power factor is not good there, when you have a big motor, if you start that motor, realize that because that motor requires a lot of current, you'll see that your light in your house will go on and off, okay? And it may happen in South Africa as well, because when you look at a big motor, a big load, that is a reactive load, it's going to require a lot of current, and then because of that current, you're going to see that your supplier is going to require a lot of current, then you see that the light will go on and off. Okay? So that is the reason of what? The reason is that because the power factor is so big, the power factor is so big in our load, so that when you start it at the beginning, it's going to require a lot of load. So this is a reactive component. And this reactive component, if it's big, at the beginning, your load will require a lot of current because it's gonna be reactive, okay? So when we talk about the power factor correction, it's all about, we want to reduce this power factor angle, because our pure load should be a resistive load. And you see, but because a load can never be so resistive, it's always gonna have a reactive component, okay? So we want to correct this power factor. To correct this power factor, it means if we are given a given load, which for instance we have a power factor 1, okay? And then this power factor 1 can be, let's say, 30 degrees. So we want to reduce, for instance, this power factor angle to a new power factor, for instance, that should be, for instance, let's say 10 degrees. Okay? So we come here, we reduce our power factor angle to a new power factor angle. What happened now? We reduce the reactive component. Now we're gonna have a X new there. Can you see that? Okay? The first triangle is the black one. After doing our power factor correction, we have a smaller angle whereby the reactive component is so small, so that when you start your motor, when you plug your load, doesn't require a lot of current, doesn't affect our supply. Okay? So that's basically what happened. So you're gonna see that you're gonna have a old power factor and a new power factor after doing your power factor correction. Okay, but the question now is, how do we do our power factor correction? Okay, so let's go back and I will explain what happened when we have to do the power factor correction. So for instance, if we're given a load, this is our impedance, okay, and then I can say this can be a motor, for instance. And then we know that this motor is made of coil. So we can say this, our motor is an inductive load. Can you see that? So how do we correct the power factor of that given motor? We just need to come, because it's the inductive load, it means XL is the dominant one. The inductor is the dominant in the circuit. So you come, you connect a capacitor in parallel with it, okay? But if we're in the case where our load is a capacitive load, you're gonna come and connect an inductor in parallel with that given load. Can you see? So every time you have to do the power factor correction, it's all about, if we're given a circuit, as I said, the calculation we are doing in chapter 1, we were looking at the total impedance. So this Z here is our total impedance, okay? So after getting your total impedance now, what you're going to do is you're going to connect a specific component. You'll be given a component where you're going to connect it in parallel with that given load so that you're going to do your power factor correction, okay? So now we're going to have two cases. As I said, an inductive load, you connect a capacitor in parallel. A capacitive load, when we mean by capacitive, you understand, it means the capacitor is the most dominant component in the circuit, okay? So after getting your the total for any given circuit, then if you have to do the power factor correction, you look, is it a capacitive or is it an inductive load? Then you're going to connect an inductor in parallel with it when it's capacitive, and then a capacitor when it's inductive, okay? So that's the first thing we're going to do. So now I'm going to split this introduction into two ways, okay? So we're going to have, more often we'll be dealing with these two cases. The first case, we'll be given a component that should be connected in parallel with our load. So let's say they give us our XL or our XC. This is the first case. The first case, the component is given, but now we are looking for the power factor in the circuit, which means the power factor 2, okay? And this power factor is basically the angle 2 in the circuit, okay? So what did I say? I said, in order for us to do the power factor correction, we used to have what? The total. For initially, we used to have a circuit where we know what is going to be our Z total. So now, they say, they give us a component. So we need to come and connect this component while in parallel with our load. And as I said, this component can be either an inductor or a capacitor. So let's say they give us the capacitor. Okay? So the change we are going to observe in this problem is that we are going to observe that we're going to have a Z nu. We're going to have a new impedance in the circuit, a new total impedance. So how do we calculate our Z nu? Our Z nu will be calculated by the old Z total times our XC and then divide by the Z total plus ZC. Okay? That will be our new impedance. In the case where they give you a component, you have to look for the power factor. You start by calculating the Z nu. And then you know that the answer you're going to get for Z nu, you're going to have the magnitude and the new angle of the power factor. Okay? So this angle of the new power factor, now you can calculate the new power factor, which is going to be cos of the new power factor angle, and then that new power factor angle will take it from Z nu, okay? And then even if they ask us to calculate the new current in the circuit, it's gonna be what? The supply, remember the supply remains the same, divide by Z nu. So first case, you should master this first set. The first case is they give you a component that is going to be connected in parallel with the load, which means with the Z total of the previous circuit. And then now, you have to calculate for the new power factor, the Z nu as well, the new current in the circuit, okay? First case. The second case is whereby they give you the new power factor, but they want you to calculate the component. Second case, they give us the new power factor, which means basically the new angle. But the question now here is, you have to calculate the unknown components. Simple. So if you master the two ways to calculate your power factor, when the power factor is unknown and when the component is unknown, it's finished. Everything is similar to chapter 1. Okay? So let's come here. But in order for us to calculate this, Z nu, remember I said what's going to be what? Q nu. These are the steps, only three steps. Q nu will be given by the old power, active power, tan of the first power factor minus tan of the new power factor. After getting this, then you calculate your XC, which is going to be given by E squared over the Q nu. So this is going to be our X nu. Remember I said, after drawing our power factor angle, I say If we change, correct the power factor, we're going to have x nu and q nu, okay? And then after doing this, this q nu will depend. If it's a capacitor, we know that x nu will be given by 1 over omega c nu. So we can calculate the component. But if you're in the case where it's an inductor, it's going to be x nu will be given by omega of L nu. So we can calculate the value of that capacitor, of that inductor. So these are the two cases that will always happen. Okay? So if you master the two way that when the component is given, you have to look for the new power factor, it's finished. If you also master how to do when they give you the new power factor and then you have to calculate for the your component, those are the only things that you have to keep in mind when it comes to chapter 2. So chapter 2 is just an additional information that you need to add to chapter 1 in order for you to correct the power factor, okay? But everything is the same as in chapter 1. So all the calculation you will do it as in chapter 1, but the only thing that is going to be added is at the end there, if they say they give you a component that is connected in parallel with your load so that you calculate the new power factor, I've explained the two cases. So you just need to master the two cases.